Carbon offsets are sold as a way to balance out your emissions, like some kind of climate penance. And jet fuel, but hey, at least someone somewhere plants a tree. So you know it's all good, right? Well, that's the sales pitch. But let's take a step back, because something about it has never quite added up for me. The last time I booked flights to Europe, I could pay about $75 to offset a flight from Australia to Europe. Meanwhile, the aviation industry screams that a carbon tax would destroy them. Really? A $75 charge on top of a $2,000 ticket is enough to cripple an industry? Come on. That alone should set off some serious alarm bells. So what's really going on with carbon offsets? Are they a legitimate tool for reducing emissions, or just a convenient excuse to keep up business as usual? Let's break it down. I'm Rosie Barnes, founder of Paddle Consulting, where we advise on clean energy technologies, helping startups with the development and investors with assessing the landscape. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. I love nature-based recreations like skiing, mountain biking, surfing. I also love my job. I spent the past 20 years developing clean energy technologies, and getting good at that has meant traveling to factories and wind farms and other clean tech projects, attending conferences, and now filming YouTube videos of cool clean technologies in places around the world. Given that I live in Australia now, traveling pretty much anywhere means getting in an aeroplane, and usually a long haul one at that. I do think hard about whether each trip is really necessary, and I try to combine multiple purposes in one. But at the end of the day, that's still a lot of traveling. And if I want to keep doing what I love, is there any way to make it climate neutral? Carbon offsets are my obvious answer. I pay money, someone somewhere promises to not cut down a tree, and poof, my emissions disappear. Or at least that's a promise. Offsets started as a way for rich countries to meet climate targets more cheaply by funding emission cuts elsewhere, like paying solar farms or forest conservation in developing nations. The idea was that these projects would cut more emissions faster than if every country only acted within its borders. In theory, that sounds great. And I used to think, yes, we should definitely do that. In practice, well, let's just say reality hasn't quite lived up to the original vision. Offsets come in two main flavors: compliance markets, where governments force entities to buy them, and voluntary markets, where entities buy them to do good, or, a more cynical take, they buy them to look good. Within each category, there are also two types of projects: preventing emissions, like funding renewables, and removing emissions, sucking carbon out of the air. Most offsets are the first kind, and that has turned out to be a bit problematic, because prevented emissions offsets don't actually take any greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere, they just claim credit for something bad not happening. That's a pretty big distinction. Of course, prevention is better than cure, but claiming that you prevented something bad from happening is pretty hard to prove. By that logic, I could claim that this rock keeps tigers away. I don't see any tigers around here, do you? Clearly, the rock works.
Lisa, I want to buy your rock.
Meanwhile, the carbon market is now worth around $1 trillion annually. That's a lot of money moving around. Yet, global emissions keep rising. Would they have risen more without all these offsets? Yeah, maybe. But there are plenty of reasons to suggest that offsets haven't made nearly as much of a difference as they were supposed to. Let's look into all the ways that they've fallen short. For offsets to actually work, they need to meet four key criteria: additionality, permanence, verifiability, and avoiding leakage. And guess what? Most don't. Additionality means the project only exists because of offset funding, but a lot of projects get funded that were going to happen anyway. In 2020, the Nature Conservancy got caught selling offsets for forests that were never at risk of being cut down. Not exactly saving the planet, is it? Permanence means that if you plant trees to store carbon, they need to stay there for centuries. But protected forests can still get logged years later or burned down. In California, entire offset projects have gone up in smoke. Literally. Oops. Verifiability means you need to prove the carbon was actually offset. Ocean-based projects, like fertilizing algal blooms to absorb CO2, sounds cool, and it's backed by real science, but it's just impossible to verify properly. Is that carbon really staying out of the atmosphere? Who knows? Leakage refers to the fact that if you protect one forest, demand for timber or paper or whatever that forest supplied doesn't just disappear. So does your offset project just mean a different forest gets logged somewhere else? This happens all the time. It's like squeezing a balloon. Push it down in one place and it just bulges out somewhere else. Poor quality carbon offsets might seem insignificant, almost like a mere accounting issue. The concept of an offset is so abstract anyway. And projects like forest preservation and other nature-based offsets come with non-emissions related benefits, like biodiversity protection. They're popular for this reason, comprising 56% of all offsets in 2021 and trading at a premium over other offset types. I heard a carbon management consultant on the Excellent Climate Now podcast recently explain away the reality that offsets often fail to offset anything at all as no big deal. According to them, investing in carbon credits can still be worthwhile, even if the benefits are a little squishy. For example, something like forest preservation has a number of benefits to ecosystems and local communities that are entirely independent to the specific amount of carbon that the forest may draw down. To paraphrase, if those carbon offset projects turned out to not sequester carbon, who cares? We still planted trees and trees are nice. The problem with that is that while the carbon sequestration might be a squishy imaginary commodity, the emissions it claims to cancel out are very real. When a company buys an offset, it's essentially a permission slip to not bother to actually change behavior, whether it's an airline dodging the cost of sustainable aviation fuel or a steelworks sticking with coal instead of switching to green alternatives. It's a shell game where the only loser is the planet and everyone who lives on it. Fake offsets aren't just a harmless accounting trick. They let companies, industries, countries keep spewing CO2 while believing themselves to be carbon neutral. So, do we just throw the concept of offsets to the bin? If we can't tell real from fake offsets, what's the point of even having them? That's where independent certification bodies come in. These organizations are meant to ensure that offsets are real, measurable, and effective. The biggest of them all is Verra, which runs the Verified Carbon Standard, the largest offset certification program in the world. Verra claims that its projects have reduced or removed over 1 billion tons of CO2 equivalent. That is huge, and it sounds fantastic. That is so great that we can now just rest assured that carbon offsets can be used to eliminate any stubborn or expensive or inconvenient emissions. Phew, this kind of reassurance led to offset markets expanding fast. The voluntary carbon market grew to a record $2 billion in 2021, up from around $300 million per year through the 2010s. That is massive and rapid expansion, but it wouldn't last. In 2023, a bombshell was dropped. An investigation by journalists from The Guardian, Deep Side, and Source Material claimed that 90% of Verra's rainforest offsets were effectively worthless. The investigation found that Verra-certified projects massively exaggerated their carbon savings. Some protected forests that were never actually under threat. Others counted emissions reductions that simply didn't happen. Verra denied the findings. But it wasn't only that one Guardian investigation. Other studies have raised serious questions about Verra-certified projects, including inflated claims and even logging in supposedly protected areas. It's not just Verra. Study after study shows that offsets fail on every one of the four key quality measures we talked about. Additionality. A study of 1,350 wind farms in India found that 52% would have been built anyway, meaning half of those offsets were meaningless. Permanence. Australian human-induced regeneration projects, supposed to restore forests, showed barely any increase in vegetation. Trees that don't exist can't store carbon. Verifiability. That Guardian-led investigation mentioned earlier found Verra-certified rainforest offsets couldn't be backed by deforestation data. Translation, the numbers were made up. Leakage. A 2023 analysis by Carbon Market Watch found that leakage is systematically underestimated or completely ignored, leading to carbon reductions on paper, but not in reality. All these issues aren't just problems for voluntary offsets. Compliance markets like the UN's Clean Development Mechanism, California's Cap and Trade Program, and Australia's carbon credit units all have been shown to have similar issues. And the market has noticed. Prices for nature-based carbon offsets, as tracked by the NGO futures market, collapsed from over $20 per ton to less than $2 within a two-year period, reflecting a broader loss of confidence in voluntary offset markets. So what happens when companies rely on a system this broken? Well, let's talk about the multi-billion dollar greenwashing problem, where companies exaggerate or misrepresent their environmental initiatives. Take Delta Airlines. They boldly declared themselves the world's first carbon neutral airline while heavily relying on carbon offsets. They even printed it on napkins. Now they're facing a lawsuit for misleading customers. Turns out, if you claim carbon neutrality while still burning jet fuel, people start asking questions. Microsoft also faced accusations of greenwashing due to their participation in a carbon offset project in Denmark, involving the capture of emissions from biomass power plants. Both Microsoft and the Danish government claimed emission reductions from this same project, sparking controversy over alleged double counting. Technically, this accusation is misplaced. Any reduction by a company would naturally contribute to the overall national reduction of the country it's in. That's not unreasonable. However, it becomes problematic if a company believes it is actively reducing emissions only to find that the host country, Denmark in this instance, can then more easily meet its own targets. Essentially, Denmark could now cut back its own offset or reduction efforts because it can count Microsoft's achievements. This leads to the question, from Microsoft's perspective, did they achieve anything beyond financially aiding the Danish government's compliance with climate goals? When a company funds a CO2 removal project in a country with a net zero target, it raises concerns about whether the new project results in greater overall reductions or merely displaces another necessary project. The sale of carbon removal credits, like those bought by Microsoft from Ørsted in Denmark, reduces atmospheric carbon only if it raises the host country's climate ambitions. This implies the country should either exclude the removed tons from their national emissions count or ramp up their climate ambitions accordingly. If they don't do this, it's not clear to me why anyone would bother to voluntarily commit to projects in that country. Offsets could, in theory, be made to work if you had airtight verification, long-term accountability, and actual incentives for companies to reduce emissions first, offset second, maybe they'd have a place. Which now brings me to a bigger question. What happens when we actually approach net zero globally? Do offsets still have a role, or do they become obsolete? That's where we need to go next. Even if offsets were perfect, which they're not, they have an expiration date. Offsets were built for a world that still runs on fossil fuels. But as we approach net zero, when the world generates its electricity from clean sources, transport is electric, forests are preserved, and remaining industrial emissions are captured, the game changes. At that point, you can't just prevent emissions, you have to actually physically remove carbon from the air. Protecting forests and funding renewables won't count as offsets anymore because deforestation should have stopped and electricity should be very close to 100% clean energy. Then the only offsets left will be negative emissions technologies like direct air capture or carbon storage. And those are way more expensive than today's cheap nature-based offsets, like 10 or 100 times more expensive. And in case you were wondering, it's not something that planting more and more trees can fix either. The potential scale of that can never come close to what we need, and research shows that there is often a lot less or even negative carbon stored compared to what was anticipated. Let's go back to the original idea of offsets. Wealthy nations funding emissions cuts in poor countries where reductions were cheaper. In theory, this was a win-win. Rich countries hit their climate targets at lower cost, and developing nations got clean energy investment. But now, as we push towards net zero, this model is starting to break down. Now that everyone has net zero targets, offsets help rich countries meet their goals, but they do so by making it harder for poorer countries to meet theirs.
First, on attracting private investment to Africa. Second, on carbon pricing and carbon credits.
There are now rules for how countries can buy offsets from each other. They're called internationally transferred mitigation outcomes, ITLUs. For example, the US can still buy credits from, say, a new wind farm in a developing country to offset emissions and allow it to keep running, say, a coal power plant. But the catch? Once those credits are sold, the host country can't count the emissions reduction they represent towards its own goals. Fast forward 20 years, when the host country's grid is fully renewable, it won't be able to claim zero emissions from its fully renewable electricity grid. Instead, it will have to add back in the emissions that the United States' now defunct coal power plant would have generated. And once the world moves beyond fossil fuels, there won't be any more cheap offsets from energy swaps. What's left? The expensive stuff. Direct capture, carbon storage, negative emissions technologies. For developing countries, this is a terrible deal. They figured it out, and that's why few are selling these kinds of offsets anymore. If they do, they need to price them at the future offset costs, because in 2050, when there are no more easy wins, offsets will cost a fortune. Cheap offsets have disappeared, and they're replaced by a new reality where real carbon removal has a real price tag. And that price tag will be more expensive than swapping to clean versions of nearly every emitting sector, including what we call hard to abate, like steel, cement, aviation, and it really just goes to show that in the long run, there is no place for offsetting instead of eliminating emissions. Carbon offsets have gone from a promising idea to a trillion-dollar illusion. They were supposed to help cut emissions, but instead, they've mostly provided cover for business as usual. Companies get to claim their net zero without changing much of anything, and countries can shuffle numbers around without actually cutting emissions. International offset trading between countries has to be a dead end. For corporations, offsets might still have a place if they genuinely fund carbon removal or speed up the transition to clean energy. There's been a lot of backlash against companies who have been perceived to be engaging in greenwashing, like the ones that I mentioned in this video, Delta and Microsoft. I do agree with aggressively calling out dodgy offsets or other green-sounding projects that don't actually benefit the environment, but I actually don't agree with too much shaming of companies for trying. If they're acting in good faith, then if they're able to use their mistakes to improve the tricky business of trying to decarbonize businesses ahead of government mandates. Delta, for example, is now buying a lot of sustainable aviation fuel to begin to directly decarbonize its operations after its offsets misstep a few years back. What about for individuals like me? If I'm going to spend money on offsets, I'm going to be damn sure they're actually going to do something. Right now, most don't. I am going to stop adding the carbon offsets to my flights because honestly, I think it might be doing more harm than good. Making it seem like customers believe dodgy cheap offsets are enough to eliminate climate impacts from flying, I think it's better to be honest that climate impacts from flying are significant and make every decision to fly mindful of the consequences. Instead of offsets, I'd rather put my money where it counts, whether that's buying sustainable aviation fuel for my flights. Though if you choose this option, be prepared that 100% sustainable aviation fuel might cost as much as your ticket. I'm also obviously supporting clean energy through my work and this channel, and funding real carbon removal technologies and restoring ecosystems for their own sake, not to cancel out emissions as usual somewhere else. At the end of the day, offsets promised an easy fix. Turns out, there isn't one. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team for their ongoing support. You can join us at this link. I've just posted on the Engineering with Rosie Discord server, exclusive for Patreons, about my home and energy makeover project that I'm working on, and it's been really good to get some input from the crew there. So if you're keen to post your own project, or you've got burning questions about the energy transition that you want to discuss, we would love to have you join us. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.